Så, då får jag hälsa er välkomna till det här Humlab-seminariet. Och idag har jag äran att få hälsa Jim Barrett välkommen också. Som ska prata om det ni ser här, The Sims as Narrative Engine. Jag tänkte också påminna er om nästa seminarium som är ganska drygt mer än 2 veckor. Den 15 november, just efter lunch också, med Anders Kjellberg från Historiska studier som kommer att prata om att 3D-modellera verkligheter. Annars blir november en ganska lugn seminariemånad för Humlab. Ja, ni har väl sett några av videoklippen här medan vi har väntat. Och jag tror inte jag tänker uppehålla Jim någon mer, utan jag ger dig ordet. And I suppose you'll be speaking English.
I am. Yeah. Yes, thank you. Hello, welcome. Today I'm going to talk about the idea of using a computer game to make films, something that is becoming more popular, very popular. It goes by the title of Machinima, which is perhaps a difficult word to spell. For me, this project began in the summer when I was at Södertörn Högskolan's summer school, the human-computer interaction and the humanities, and I submitted a paper on Machinima, or the Sims as narrative engine. For me, what was really interesting was that it was a meeting point between telling a story and playing a game, which is in game theory circles, it's a bit contentious, the idea of game and story. A lot of discussion goes on about this. But the meeting between ludology and narratology in the Machinima, that opened it up to me. And what's I've noticed in looking at Machinima is that storytelling has become a game in a goal, a goal in the game, and story making has become a game in itself also. There's Activision game company has just released a game called, or is about to release, I think in November, a game called The Movies, where you are a movie maker, you're in Hollywood, and you're actually making the films in the game also, and then you have to go through public reception with these films, and it's part of the game process. But then that's interesting because it's your storytelling in your game, and how well you tell stories or the appeal of these stories, that becomes part of the game. Through this, at the end of this paper or this seminar, I'll give all the links that I'm talking about, because not much of this is actually original. Most of it is ideas I've taken from other people. Just to begin, also, how many people have played either The Sims or Halo or Half-Life or World of Warcraft? Something about Machinima, I think, in order to understand it or to make it, you have to be a gamer also, I think. You have to know about games to have a depth to your with your tools and the world that you're inhabiting when you're making these films. And the game that I chose to look at, or the platform that I chose to look at, was The Sims, which is very popular. And The Sims series, rather than being called a game, it was described by its designer, Will Wright, as a software toy. Other people describe it as a simulation. The idea of game as having a goal, it's difficult to pinpoint a single goal in The Sims. You can lose your characters, they can die, they can be unhappy, but you have to maintain a sort of a standard of living through the game, and it just keeps going. So I would describe The Sims in the context of this seminar as an engine of narrativity. Simply put, it can be used to tell stories that only exist after the game has been played. A machinima is both a production technique and a genre, whereby the imagery generated from virtual world game engines is rendered in real time into a film-like format. This is interesting also, and I'll talk more about this towards the end of the seminar. This is a digital medium. And because it's digital, there's dramatic differences between the two formats, film and digital. One of the most glaring differences is the field of view in Machinima. The field of view in an average Machinima film is 90 degrees, compared to the greatest possible field of view in a 35 millimeter film is 52.9 degrees. So you're expanding. Most Machinima shots you could only accomplish in film if you used a fisheye lens. But when you're watching the Machinima, you don't notice it. Suddenly you're sort of in the world. I'll show some later and you'll see that. So it also has infinite depth of field focus. And that's something that a lot of early filmmakers were trying to achieve. I've actually, since I've started looking at Machinima, I've also been watching early Russian filmmakers, Vertov and these people. It's very interesting to compare the two. That the information about field of view and depth of field came from Gordon MacDonald, who wrote an essay that's online called Machinima Theory. And I'll be quoting him a few times. And another quote from Gordon is that if you look at multi-map piece of Machinima drama, you'll begin to see some of the stylistic differences creeping in. For example, almost all Machinima to date uses fade to black to cover the loading between scenes that change maps. In a film, this would denote a passage of time, while with Machinima, it is glossed over as part of the medium. The relationship between space and time in Machinima is not the same as it is in film, and I'll talk more about that too. But on the Wikipedia, on the internet, there's a very big entry under Machinima. I'll quote a small portion of that. A Machinima is a portmanteau word for Machinima cinema or machine animation. It's both a collection of associated production techniques and a film genre, a film created by such production techniques. As a production technique, the term concerns the rendering of computer-generated imagery using low-end 3D engines, as opposed to high-end and complex 3D engines used by professionals, such as Pixlr. This is not the technique that Pixlr use. They're in another realm. But this is comes much, much cheaper than anything Pixlr does and can be done in a much quicker time. That's why people are attracted to it. Also, typically, engines in first-person shooter games are being used, but that's also beginning to change. Machinima was created when amateur and independent filmmakers started using real-time renderings from 3D graphic engines. The same stuff that powers gameplay is used to produce movies. The first game with Machinima capabilities was Stunt Island in 1992. Doom was released, when the first Doom game was released in 1993, it included support for the recording and playback of gameplay demos. In the 70s and 80s, there were a lot of computer enthusiasts who were using demos, films, writing their own programs and sending them to each other. But it was just demonstrating the technology. Then in 1996, Quake saw Machinima break out into communities. It's a community. Online communities, virtual communities, are supporting this network of filmmaking. There's not a lot of money in it at this stage for most people, but there is an incredibly large amount of films being made. And as an example, currently there are 8,000 Machinima films on the Electronic Arts website. They're the people that make The Sims. That's just one website. On the World of Warcraft website, there are also thousands. And that's interesting also, the companies that are making these games are hosting the films. And it's actually copyrighted material that's being used in these films. But that's also another grey area in the Machinima world. Generally speaking, there are two ways that Machinima is made. Creating or finding an audio-based script and then working the visuals around that as best you can, with adjustment and compromise being made along the way. Or number two, filming visual in-game action and then constructing the audio around the visual content with less adjustment and compromise and more improvisation as you go along. The first of these, that is doing the script first and then creating the action, seems to be gaining steadily in popularity and today involves the hacking of game engines, That's the software used to make games. The making of 3D models, specifically for filming, and construction of audio that not only includes dialogue, but sound effects and synchronized sound. So I have a couple of shots of production here. You can buy, there are two books at the moment you can buy about making Machinima, just released in the last 12 months. This gentleman's doing sound for a Machinima production. There are maybe three new Star Wars films that have been made in Machinima, using the cinema the games based on the cinema, the original cinema. This is 3D modeling of characters. So, skins and oh, that was that. That last shot was the film I was talking about, the movies. I think it's about to be released. I'll just show you some... The main film that I worked with, the two films that I worked with in this project were called The Awakening 1 and 2. They were made in Sims. And they were just online films that I found in a Sims community site. And this is a trailer for the first and the second of the Awakening films.
Leroy, I'm not crazy. Something's happening to me. I see things that other people don't see.
That was actually the second one, but the first one might help.
Alan was an ordinary Sim with an ordinary life until one day. Discovery that would change his life. None of that actually happened. Chen? What's that green thing above your head?
These films were made by April Hoffman, who I think she works as a personal trainer. Lives in, I'm not sure if it's Texas or California. So I'll talk a lot more about The Awakening. To return to some of the to the ideas of how these are made, this is an early and very famous Machinima film. It's only short, but it's made in a game community, and it's emphasizing the technology. It's not a narrative, really. It's called Warthog
Tank.
Jump.
Load the jump program.
Precise hit will set up a chain reaction. The shaft is ray shielded, so you'll have to use proton torpedoes.
That's impossible, even for a computer.
It's not impossible. I used to bullseye womp rats in 1916 back home. They're not much bigger than 2 meters.
Not really much of a narrative here, but it's they're using the game for not really for an intended purpose. But this is a few years old. I'm not sure. It's made using Halo 2 and Apple iMovie. For the Awakening films, April makes, I think, using the film program, the film capture program that comes with The Sims, and then edits in another program. I'm not sure which one she used, another video program. This actually was shown, Espen Aarseth shows this film in some of his presentations, and some Americans that were at the summer school found it quite difficult with what they've been watching on television coming out of Iraq. So, a violent piece of cinema. And then the last thing I'll show you is something I thought was interesting, because it's using, this man has made a whole film in Machinima based on the film with Tom Cruise and Jack Nicholson, The Few Good Men. And this is called A Few Good G-Men. That was Deformation 1, Deformation 2. Is it this one? No. Oh, no.
Lieutenant Kendrick ordered the code red, didn't he? Because that's what you told Lieutenant Kendrick to do.
Object! And when it went bad, you offensive. Cut these guys loose!
Your Honor,
you had margins inside a bony transport!
Your Honor,
you doctored the logbook!
Damn it, Captain!
You coerced the doctor!
Consider yourself in contempt!
You. Colonel Jessup, did you order the code red?
You don't have to answer that question.
I'll answer the question.
You want answers?
I think I'm entitled.
You want answers?
I want the truth!
You can't handle the truth!
That was made in Half-Life 2. So, Machinima are not animated films in the sense of cartoon or digital anime. They combine elements in a convergence of media forms, film, animation, and game. And there is as well something that I've thought of is the idea of surveillance camera, the pervasive eye. You're watching something. A lot of these game environments, you don't actually know what's going to happen. But you keep filming the characters until the action happens that you want. You can't completely control your Sims characters. You can only set up the environment and then watch them. So this is the pervasive eye of surveillance camera, closed circuit TV in public spaces. And I think I would think of massive multi-online role-playing games as public spaces also. This watching becomes a story, and it's a similar aesthetic would be if I accessed the security cameras of central London and created a film about the images and interactions I found. Of course, there would be real people rather than avatars, but the idea of a story emerging from a monitored or controlled space in its recounting, and this is something I've got a quote later that they actually say we have a controlled space, we can use this controlled space to make stories. The players of The Sims, who are simultaneously creating the Machinima films, must engage with the program on a level deeper than that of an animator and more akin to a camera-eyed security guard or documenting social scientist. The inclusion of added sound in Machinima as voices, effects and ambience in non-diegetic or outside the actual story to narrative in a somewhat similar way than the piano player added the atmosphere to early silent films. In this relationship, the intentionality towards narrative is clear as being minimal in the field of play but emphasized in the recounting. The makers of Sims Machinima, and I think most Machinima filmmakers, Machinimists they're called, most often belong both to online community of the players and the online community of those who are making films using game engines, with the inclusion of video and other media capturing functions in several 3D gaming programs now, including The Sims 2, and the lower weapon command in Halo 2, I would suggest that the concept of emergent gameplay, that's something that Machinima has been called up till now, is emergent gameplay. I think it's shifted in respect to Machinima, and whilst not actually part of the game itself, it's now completely anticipated by the game's manufacturers, and it's encouraged. The two films that I discuss here, both made in 2005 by April Hoffman, the first two in a planned trilogy entitled The Awakening 1 and 2, which you saw the previews for. And these are both examples of complex and artistic Sims Machinima films where considerable time, a huge amount of time, is spent making these, constructing a story around the activities of in-world avatars. Hoffman outlines how she constructs a film on her own website. She says, I write my script first, then record the voices, and then film my scenes to try and best match the voices. I film much more footage than I need since it can be difficult to find appropriate action to match the voices. Some people record the film first and then add the voices, so really it's up to you. In this proposed structure, it's somewhat difficult to identify clear stages of narrative coalescence, even with a script being the first stage of production. Hoffman also points out elsewhere that a script is by no means the rigid structure by which the story is held up. And this is another quote from April. One thing to remember is the only good writing is rewriting, so don't get too tied to an idea once you've had it. Keep working and reworking until it's just right. A balance is here recommended in the production process between what is desired by the filmmaker and what is actually occurring in the scenes being filmed. Examples of intrusive game content in films are the thought bubbles and plum bobs, the clouds and green diamonds, which often appear over avatars' heads in The Sims. And they are encoded features of the gameplay that are difficult to remove totally from a film scene. If you watch the entire of the Awakening films, it's very well done how game content is sort of pushed back, and you don't see the thought bubbles unless it's a overt reference. But that's part of the narrative of the films, which I'll describe. A catalogue of cheats has been compiled by both Sims movie makers and it's on the official Maxis site, the game manufacturer's site, where the perimeters of the game structure are either directly manipulated, that is, hacked, or used in ways not intended but allowed by the actual inbuilt structure. And that was the central feature of the warthog jump exploding vehicles thing. That was a feature of the game that was not intended, but it was exploited by the filmmaker. Many of these cheat codes are also used by gamers in the field of play in order to bring about game outcomes closer to the desires of the players themselves. In both instances, the software users are exploiting the material structures of the game codes in order to achieve desired outcomes in shorter amounts of playing time. This situation positions both the software user and the game player as an active agent in the succession of events within the game or the text. As to the strengths of making Machinima in The Sims, Hoffman stated in an interview, "One advantage I can see in using The Sims compared to, say, first-person shooter games is there is probably a bigger variety of stories that can be told, being that The Sims game is about life in general and not just about a conquest to kill an enemy. Also, Maxis comes out with expansion packs every 6 months. The movie-making options will continue to expand." But this excerpt from Few Good Men, it was made in a first-person shooter game. But by sandwiching the soundtrack, in the whole film is just the complete soundtrack of the film with the visuals from the game. So I think it's quite engaging. But, I mean, there is a stiltedness about the characters, but you get drawn into the dialogue, the voice, the power of the voice telling the story. A quote from a recent article in the New York Times, it was from August, "The work of another high-quality Machinima production group, Rooster Teeth, is done in a similar way, according to the New York Times article, Xbox Auteurs, or Tours. The Rooster Teeth crew record the voiceovers earlier in the day. Now they are going to create the animation for the final scene." Rooster Teeth have made, I think, three series for MTV, The Strangerhood, Red versus Blue, and then there's a new one out I can't remember the name of. These are all downloadable. Even MTV is allowing you to download these for free off the internet, but they're also being shown on MTV as well. The expansion packs for The Sims so far, Hot Date, Sims University, and The Herbs, Sims in the City. And this sort of opens up a whole new lot on filmmaking. You've suddenly increased the subject matter for your film by the game expanding. To explain a bit about the Awakening films, Hoffman's films made with the Awakening title could be classified under the popular genre of virtual real, whereby the main character suspects that the world in which they inhabit is not what it seems, and technology, their own ignorance, or an unseen and often sinister power is keeping them imprisoned within a particular belief system. The Matrix trilogy, that was 1999 to 2003 by the Wachowski brothers, is perhaps the most popular recent example of such a film. In The Awakening, the main character, Alan, suspects he is in some sort of simulacra world which is controlled by an unseen power. For the viewers for The Awakening films, as for the players of The Sims, it is clear that a Sims avatar is in an artificial world, and they are a portion of the unseen powers controlling their lives. This reflexivity of the film begins with a reference to the gaming structures of The Sims, such as the need to use the telephone to leave the house because a car come and pick up the Sims character to take them to work. The speed at which the fire brigade, the actual film begins with an accidental fire in the kitchen, which is a common occurrence in The Sims. I lost a few Sims because I forgot to buy a fire extinguisher because you can't do anything once they start burning. You just watch. So Alan lights a fire. He has a fire, the fire brigade comes. He lights another one, the fire brigade comes, and each thing happens the same way every time. And also the sudden appearance of a pizza delivery car out of thin air each time a pizza is ordered. I have some footage of this.
I had a fire this morning, and...
Oh my gosh, are you okay?
Yeah, I'm fine. Actually, I had... 3 fires this morning.
How did...
Wait, let me finish. The first one was an accident, I admit. But when the firemen got here, something just seemed a little odd.
Isn't it great how fast they respond?
But that's the point, Jen. It was too fast. So I lit another fire to make sure. Not only did he get here just as fast, but when he left, he said exactly the same thing as the first time.
So? That's what firemen say.
But he said it the third time, too. And he got here just as fast. It's like he appeared out of nowhere. I mean, don't you find that a little odd?
Yes. I mean, not really.
Okay. Let me ask you this. Where do you live?
Across the street. You know that.
Then look!
What?
Do you see your house?
No.
But if it's across the street, then why can't you see it?
Well, of course you can't see it from your house, silly.
I can see your lot. Why can't I see your house?
Oh, I don't know. You just can't.
Okay, let's try something different. Hello. Yeah, I'd like to order pizza, please. Yeah, large. Pepperoni's fine. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay. Thanks a lot. Okay, follow me. Come on, Jen, hurry up.
I'm coming. What's going on, Alan?
Okay, Jen, now watch down the street, and I'll bet you that a pizza car will just sort of appear. See?
Maybe there's fog.
Fog? No! Now watch this. I bet that instead of walking up to me to give me my pizza, he's just going to walk straight to the door and ring the bell.
Well, why wouldn't he do that? He's delivering your pizza.
But we're standing right here. Why doesn't he just come right to us? See, I told you. Hello, pizza guy. We're over here. Hello. Hello? Excuse me.
So, these events provoke questioning of his own condition by Alan, and he starts conducting experiments about the nature of his reality. His sometimes desperate behavior disturbs those people around him, particularly his girlfriend, and he becomes more and more bizarre. In the second of the films, there is a visit by a Mr. Wright, who warns Alan against making trouble and promises him large amounts of money if he resumes his former unquestioning life. And I have a clip of this.
Alan.
This is Will Wright, the designer of The Sims.
Who? My name is Mr. Wright, and I'm with the Maxis Corporation.
The what? Corporation? Ah!
That's not important right now.
How did
what
you...
What is important is that you are causing a disturbance.
A disturbance? What do you call this? Who are you? Did you do this to my house? Ah! Stop doing that.
Don't worry about your house. You'll get a new one. That is, if you choose to cooperate.
Cooperate? What is this? Who are you? You're the one controlling us. What do you want?
I want you to stop this behavior. Stop planting ridiculous ideas into the heads of your friends. Stop digging holes in your
yard. Why did you fill that hole in? What are you trying to hide?
Alan, we're prepared to make you an offer. If you will stop this behavior, go back to living your normal daily life, we would be willing to give you as much money as you could ever need.
You're going to give me money to be quiet? Why? If you're the one in control, then why don't you just make me stop?
It's a good offer. I strongly suggest you take it.
No, no, I can't take it. I won't take it. I need answers. I have to know what's going on.
I'll give you some time to think it over. And perhaps a few accidents that will help you make your decision.
Wait. What do you mean?
Call Jen. She might know better what I'm talking about.
Jen? What would... Oh, no! Jen?
The movies are downloadable, and I'll give you the addresses at the end. So this is like, you're watching a reflexive reference between the game and the story. It's being, the story is being made in a game, and the story is about the game, but you can't really understand the story unless you're familiar with the game also. You must acknowledge that this is an artificial world, a narrative world, but it's a game. So, and of course, I think the more you're in the Sims gaming community, the more the humor affects you, the more you understand the code of the story. Because the third and concluding film in the series has not been released, we don't know how it ends for Alan, the self-aware Sim. Hoffman comments on this necessity for temporal cohesiveness and the difficulties that can be experienced in achieving it when she states again in Machinimag 6 article, The New Shape of Machinima, I work in a very linear fashion, this is a quote, I work in a very linear fashion in that I film scene by scene in order. I usually can envision what I want in these scenes, so I'll shoot it in many different times from different angles. And if I know exactly how I want it to look, then I'll shoot it enough times for the Sim to cooperate and not think while he's performing the action. The idea that the avatar is cooperating suggests a wish for a seamless technological experience between the game, the film's manufacture, and the showing. There is also the agency of such avatars in performing the action as an objective stance of the interactive game against the subjective film of the machinery representation. The voyeuristic objectification, the player as the eye on the wall, of watching the Sims 2 avatar in their short lives has been replaced by a participatory subjectification in the machinima representation. There are, however, the majority of online machinima films which are merely reproduced game action. Of these 8,000 films on the Maxis site, a lot of them are just like avatars kissing each other or drowning or things like this. There's not a lot of content. The added audio capacity of digital film production allows for the images taken to be explained or constructed with coherent speech, sophisticated sound effects, and scene-appropriate music. In the Sims world themselves, the avatars don't speak. They just sort of gibber little sounds. But it's sequenced. They gibber to each other in sort of a symbolic form of conversation. It is the audio of the machinima films which is the most obvious, totally new addition to what began as game content in the filmmaking process. In The Sims 2, avatars speak gibberish, and ambient sound is largely restricted to poorly synchronized, minimal diegetic sounds. That's toilet flushing, sound of burning, fire alarm in the event of fire. And the muzak soundtracks, or audio files chosen and uploaded by the player. You can program your own music in The Sims. In Hoffman's films, ambient sound is synchronized in such settings as footsteps, doors opening and closing, bird song, digging, chewing food, even clothes rustling in movement. She's gone that far to make that. And the effect is amazing. It really draws you into the story. Spoken dialogue in the Awakening films is the key to the visual sequences, with Alan explaining his suspicions and fears to all that will listen, including direct address to the camera and the viewer, speaking to us and explaining what's going on. The visual field of digital world programs such as The Sims is the dominant media form in such games, although sound is increasingly playing a role in providing the game experience. From a critical perspective, although I have been slightly critical, I contend that Machinima provides us with an example of what Jerome McGann termed in Radiant Textuality, as 2001 publication, as deformance. that the object of critical reflection is not ultimately directed to the sign as such, this is a quote, but to the rhetorical scene and its functional social operators, not least of all the persons engaged in the acts of deformance we commonly locate in the file-headed interpretation. So if you are negotiating a text such as The Sims, you're interpreting it. But then if you're making a Machinima film, you're also interpreting The Sims. But you're providing a material artifact in that interpretation, which can be shared and creates new artifacts and new understandings. McGann goes on to say, interpretation of works of imagination call for responsive works of imagination, not reflexive works of analysis. I think that's what drew me into Machinima, is that it is a creative form of analysis. In regards to The Sims and perhaps games more generally, Machinima positions the new convergent media in a distinct and cinematic mode of production, or CMP. And this, following Jonathan Beller's 1998 essay Kino Eye, Kino World, film is discrete or procedural. It's a production line aesthetic. Beller argues that our consciousness has been formed by film production, and we think in a certain way due to the media that we have been exposed to for 100 years now. And in this cinematic mode of production, value is created through looking. Beller terms this the attention theory of value. But then thinking about digital imagery, it is not sequential in the same way as film. It's simultaneous. And it's spatial rather than time-dependent. And going back to the earlier quote about the fades, the montage technique in Machinima, where it goes to a black space before it changes scenes, it's not necessarily a progression of time. I think in Machinima, we're seeing a new manifestation in that it's more spatial than it is time-based. It's spatial rather than time-dependent. All the information is there. It is arranged as pixels corresponding to set values. The unique black screen montage referred to in the earlier Gordon McGann quote further points to the spatial field being used to tell a story rather than a time-based narrative being unfolded for the viewers. We watch the visual signs in Machinima rather than wait for them. In the deformation critique provided by Machinima, we can see that it is only beginning to emerge from a cinematic mode of production where the material of the medium can be entered into and manipulated. If you look at early film in the early 20th century, a lot of experimental avant-garde directors, they scratched into the film. And that's as close as they could come to entering into the material of it. Walter Benjamin writes a lot about this in his work. But in digital medium, you can go into the code and you can do anything. It's not a surface, it's a space. Looking at the plot of the Awakening films, a tension is established between the experiences of Alan and the nature of the game. The holes in the game, these things that don't make logical sense, the pizza of a vehicle appearing out of air and things like that, these holes are critiqued through Hoffman's Machinima projects, as well as the boundaries of representation, the logical, narratological, being emphasized. In both these examples, we can see a philosophical or psychological line of narrative inquiry that is yet to be strongly represented in gaming. This is the depth of narrative that is needed in computer gameplay if the medium is to develop to what I personally believe could be an astounding representational and even literary potential. A combination of deformation and a critique of the cinematic mode of production in Machinima emphasizes the manipulation of space rather than time, as in film, and this I would describe as a digital aesthetic. Finally, the last section is just moving on to some ideas about the future. These are some images from new games or new Machinima productions. The graphics is becoming a very high quality in games. These are some shots from new games. And also from Machinima. I think they're games that are being used as Machinima. I took them from a Machinima site. And from a recent article in the Escapist online magazine. One of the areas of interest is copyright in this medium because it's all appropriated. And according to R.L. Sutich in The Escapist, a bigger copyright threat to the art of machinima lies in its producer's habit of borrowing popular soundtracks. Last week, rpgfilms.net, a popular website that hosts many of these videos, was sent an email that was originally believed to be from the Recording Industry Association of America. The email took an ominous tone of a cease and desist letter, using the dreaded term copyright infringement. RPG Films took themselves offline until it was discovered that the email was a hoax. The RIAA denies sending the letter, but still holds the option of sending a real one. The game companies are very keen for people to make machinima. It's free advertising. It's a community. But the soundtracks, the people making the sounds, are not so keen. My predictions for the future. It'll only be a matter of time before we see machinima as a mainstream release at chain cinemas. But the grassroots community will continue as long as copyright law holds them outside the mainstream. So far, the big games companies and Microsoft have tolerated use of copyrighted content in machinima. MTV is using several machinima formatted programs in its broadcasting. These are either paid for work created by machinima production companies such as Rooster Teeth, or paid for video promotions of music releases. It's interesting, now there's a Christine Aguilera avatar in Sims, and there's also, I think, a Britney Spears avatar. But I'm not sure, I haven't seen a video with these avatars in them. And I'm not sure who owns the avatars. I'm not sure how you download them, but there was an unveiling of the new stars who have avatars in Sims World. I also know that McDonald's pays rent in the online world for Sims. McDonald's pays rent for their restaurant in the online world. So it's this boundary that's very fuzzy. Machinima is very cheap to make and much faster than other computer animation techniques, although at this stage the visual quality is not equal, but it's getting close, as you can see. 3D modeling and game engine hacks seem to be the way of the future for machinima, where the hit-and-miss voyeurism of the cottage industry machinima community will coexist with more complex techniques and narratives. And then returning to this idea of surveillance, this is a quote from Gordon MacDonald, the co-founder of Strange Company with Hugh Hancock. He's a camera and sound man of all of Strange Company films. He's the main web designer on machinima.com. That's a fan site for machinima. And he says, "We have a completely controllable environment. Our cast is physically entirely under our control, and neither they nor the camera nor any other part of our production has to obey physical rules. The only real disadvantage we have is the primitive state of our current tool set, and then that's just a matter of programming some new tools. I think that when we get our own tools designed by machinimators, full machinimators, that are fully integrated into an engine tailored especially to our needs, we will be able to achieve some truly spectacular results." And then all this can be found. I have 32 links to machinima sites here, both sites with films, theory, people who are making it, news articles. And that's the end of my presentation. Are there any questions? Thank you. Some of the game programs have video capture. There's also, we're using one here, Camtasia. That's a screen capture program we use here that's being used. The only experience I've had with this is in The Sims, and I just used The Sims video program, and I made some short films myself. And then people are using, I know Director, people are starting to use that to edit the video. A lot of the games come with video programming in them now. And then editing, and then sound, You could use sound programs too. You could choose high quality sound recording equipment, make your own sound. You could do video effects, and once it's captured from the game, it's film, and then you can change it, digital film, and it's changeable along those lines.
How strong is the is it possible to say anything about the link between the game and the actual production? I mean, the film or whatever. I mean, is there a problem with getting too far away from the game, also visually or?
No, I think it would exist. I think one of the strengths of that Awakening films is the reference to the game in the dialogue, and that it becomes humorous, and that there's a tension there between the two. And then there's the quality. I mean, the material that you're dealing with will affect your outcomes as far as narrative is concerned. As April Hoffman said, that The Sims is not a first-person shooter. So you can develop storylines based on families or this sort of activity, group situations. You don't have to worry about having guns in the shot. Having a family who are heavily armed would change the narrative, or would make a tension between the dialogue and what you're seeing. It has to synchronize, I suppose. Most of the first-person shooter machinimist films I've seen are not as developed. If there are guns in the shot, then that drives the story in some way. If there are no guns in the shot, in the visuals, then there's a more interpretation of what's going on possible.
Any examples of Machinima productions with clear references to two games?
Two games.
I mean, as in several games.
No. Or is it? I don't think one? So. I'm not sure. I think it's difficult to work across platforms.
Yeah.
Once you're locked into your game engine, you are locked into it.
Mm.
This Rooster Teeth film, Red versus Blue, it's about a couple of soldiers who don't want to fight. And they're in combat situations, but they're having tremendous problems in the combat. But it's a first-person shooter game. But they're playing off the idea of the violence of the game. But they're using it negatively, saying, we don't want to participate in this. And, you know, I don't enjoy killing, but I have to do it. I'm forced to somehow. So that's why it's so interesting. The connection with the game and the story is not clearly broken at any time. It's everything I've seen so far is a dialogue between the game and the story via the medium.
Any more comments? Eller frågor, det går bra. Svenska eller engelska?
Ja.
I have never used Sims. But if you want to use more than one character, it's a group.
Mm.
Do you have to be four or five people moving those characters?
No. You set up a situation and then they take care of themselves. But you have to be aware of their food, their hygiene. They have to have money. They have to have interests. They have to be educating themselves. Linda, the artist here, she recently lost her hard drive on her computer at home, and she was very upset because she lost 9 generations of Sims on her hard drive, and she said it felt like a family, or 9 generations of a family had gone. So you can build a huge city all around playing just alone with the Sims, and you have to you set the perimeters for their experience, and then these perimeters are measured against the game rules. You can't like starve them. They have to wash. They have to do certain things in order to survive and to have children and have relationships and this sort of thing. So it's a simulation for a group, and it's, I would say, you could have hundreds of characters just of your own if you were very devoted to the game. It would take a lot of time to keep this going, keep a world of that size going. And then there's The Sims Online, which I haven't had experience with. It's a bit different because you're playing against other people. Their neighbors are really, there are people who are controlling them that you don't know about. So.
Någon som har några fler kommentarer eller synpunkter? I was wondering about the I mean, spoken dialogue thing as well, because it, and looking at game development and looking at the game, well, game or interactive story or whatever that we've been playing with here in the lab, Facade,
yeah,
where you have, I mean, the difference that real voice makes.
Yeah.
And if you, you know, I guess that's also a potential development in as far as the game industry is concerned. I mean, it's just the it's an interesting effect, I think.
Yeah, it's a very powerful effect.
Yeah, it's a big
but
step.
I remember Linda Bell's presentation here about artificial voice and response, and it's very difficult. It's very complex. But if thinking of travel also, if that's possible, to put voice into the visual, and then somehow our brains work, the psychology of narrative, we put these things together ourselves in a dialogue. And if you're seeing an image, this the reason why I chose the Half-Life clip with Jack Nicholson and Tom Cruise was because their voices anyway, because it's very famous and people know it. And the power of that familiarity drives you into the situation. But then I thought what was brilliant was the shot that went from the lawyer, Tom Cruise's character, it panned around to Jack Nicholson, but it stopped at the judge. And he was this old African-American guy with like a tattered clothes on sitting on the judge's bench, which is a bit of a twist, not what you would expect to see. I don't know who played the judge in the original film, but it was a unexpected point. But the voices were driving you through the pictures with this power drawing you in. So,
yeah. I guess there will be time for looking at more of these examples as well and stuff. I have one more question as well, if you don't have any more, about the thing you mentioned about the quality of the graphics and whether you have observed any discussion in these online forums about, I mean, is that a problem or is it seen as something that's a good thing? Because I imagine if you're working with, in relation to these games, and let's say they, I mean, many of them are becoming much more advanced graphically and more photorealistic and everything, I assume that if you're going to maintain, you know, that level of graphics, or if you're relating to that level of graphics, you also have to produce graphics that's more advanced, which is much more time-consuming and costly as well. Because it seems to be a nice level in these, I mean, The Sims has a kind of cartoonish feeling to it.
There's a lot about the shots too, with this conversation between Alan and Mr. Wright. There were no headshots, hands, this sort of thing. Just, it gave it a nice ambience, I think, the scene, because you were not getting clear pictures, but somehow you create it, and it also draws you into the shot. With photorealism, I'm not sure if it is the right way to go, but then it depends what sort of photorealism. These last images I was showing, they are... they're artistic photorealism. They're not, they're almost cartoonish, but it's the lighting, I think, and shading that makes it, and the space. But there's a high, it's another meeting of art and game also, which is another whole seminar. It's interesting as well. But I don't think we'll be seeing, that's something you see in the Pixlr films, I think. I remember in Finding Nemo, that is, parts of that are very photorealistic, and not exaggerated. They're trying to create an animated, realistic world. And that's good, that works. But I don't know if it is a focus for Machinima. It's almost hyper-realism, some of it, too. Why would you have a lighthouse in a lake?
Why not?
Yeah. Yeah, there's these worlds, they don't have to obey logical or narratological structures or spatial structures. But somehow you can convince the viewer, once you've managed to lull the viewer into the story, you can convince them of these things, that it makes sense, that it holds together as a sequence. That's probably one of the main strengths of Machinima and something that'll be emphasized in the future.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you.